You have billions of William Shakespeare's atoms inside of you right now. If you make a habit of watching science videos on YouTube, maybe you've heard that kind of claim before. And you can see why it's appealing. Who wouldn't like the idea of having a little bit of the bard or any other great person from history inside of them? But is this true? And also, how do we know? Well, strap in because I'm about to break it down for you and the numbers are gonna get really, really big. To figure out how many bits of Shakespeare are in you, first we need to know how many there were to go around. Like everything else in the universe, the bard was made entirely of atoms. There were a variety of different elements, but mainly carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen, phosphorus, and calcium. Together, those six elements make up about 99% of our bodies. So for our purposes moving forward, we can ignore everything else. Now, when you know the elemental composition of a thing and you know the mass of a thing, you can work out the number of atoms in that thing. An average body weighs approximately 80 kilograms and is made up of the six elements I mentioned before in decreasing quantities. And from those elements' masses and proportions, we can calculate that there are roughly 7 octillion, or 7 times 10 to the 27th, atoms in the average human body. But it's not as simple as that because human bodies are surprisingly impermanent. Around 98% of all of the atoms inside our bodies are swapped out regularly as the living tissues are renewed. The fastest molecule to be recycled is water, containing a ton of our body's hydrogen and oxygen. Around 60% of our bodies are made up of water, and scientists estimate that around half of this is replaced every 8 days. Carbon, sodium, and potassium are major constituents of soft tissues and are also recycled quickly. But calcium and phosphorus, which are the stuff of bones and teeth, tend to stick around for longer. Regardless, many of the atoms that leave our body in our breath, sweat, urine, and feces were a part of us once. Let's look at breathing first. The average volume of a breath is about half a liter, but since about 75% of the air we inhale is inert nitrogen that the body can't use, less than 25% of each breath is actually exchanged with the body. But even in just that quarter of a breath, we shed about 10 sextillion atoms. Multiply that by an average of 15 breaths per minute, and you get 8 million breaths a year, amounting to 80 octillion atoms shed through breath alone. We can do the same with solid and liquid waste. On average, we produce 128 grams of feces and 1.4 liters of urine per day, which together contribute to about 100 octillion atoms released that way every year. So if we're trying to calculate how many Shakespearean atoms there were to go around, we need to consider all of these sources. The bard lived in England during the 16th century, and he resided there for 52 years before his death in 1616. He was buried at Holy Trinity Church in Stratford-upon-Avon, and his body would have decomposed for more than a decade until all that was left was a skeleton. Actually, a little less than a full skeleton. In 2016, radar scans of his tomb appeared to show that the playwright's skull was missing, thought to be looted by grave robbers, so we might have to rule that out of our calculations, but as we'll see, it won't make that much of a difference. Shakespeare had 7 times 10 to the 27th atoms in him when he died, most of which would have gradually made their way into the environment. But much more significant were the atoms that he released during his lifetime. Over his 52 years, he breathed out about 4 nonillion, or 4 times 10 to the 30th atoms, and peed and pooped another 5 nonillion. Together, that makes 9 nonillion atoms, which is 1,000 times more than he was still hoarding in his body when he died. So these 9 nonillion atoms have been out in the wild for the last 400 years. And to find out what happened to them, we need to shift our focus from the small to the very large. On the whole, the Earth is kinda clingy, at least when it comes to its atoms. Since everything arrived here about 4.5 billion years ago, almost everything has stayed, compelled by the force of bonding in solids, cohesion in liquids, and gravity acting on gases. There is a slow leak at the top of the atmosphere where the lightest elements, hydrogen and helium, are escaping at a rate of about 1 kilogram per second. But while that might sound like a lot, if we were talking about a leaky tire, on the scale of the atmosphere,
It's insignificant.
So just about all of the elements that have ever been on Earth stayed here and are cycled through the ground, air, water, and living things. And the so-called biogeochemical cycle of each element looks a bit different. Carbon, for example, is a major component of all organisms. We're about 18% carbon, and a big portion of the Earth's carbon cycle passes through living things. The element is absorbed from the atmosphere by plants and algae during photosynthesis. Those plants are eaten by animals, the carbon is passed along, and the element is ultimately released again during respiration and decomposition. Another big portion of the world's carbon is in the atmosphere, in the form of carbon dioxide. Quite a bit of that CO2 dissolves into the oceans to make a weak carbonic acid. And with or without the help of living things, calcium carbonate can precipitate out and lock away some of the carbon in sedimentary rocks for hundreds of millions of years. Nitrogen is another important element on the Earth and in our bodies. It makes up 78% of the air and about 3% of living things. But nitrogen doesn't cycle quite as easily as carbon does. To change from an inert gas in the atmosphere to the nitrates that living things use, it needs to be fixed in chemical reactions that require bacteria or lightning to happen. Once bound inside tissues, it follows much the same fate as carbon, being passed along when organisms are eaten and released again when those organisms die. And then there's water, which is the planet's biggest reserve of hydrogen and oxygen. 71% of the surface of the Earth is covered in the stuff, and human bodies are 60% water too. It evaporates from the oceans, condenses into clouds, moves around through the atmosphere, then rains down to the ground where it flows over or under the surface. It's taken up by living things, released when they don't need it anymore, and ultimately ends up back in the ocean. There are so many different places water can go, and each place hangs onto it for a different amount of time. A water molecule might spend 3,000 years in the oceans, 9 days in the atmosphere, and hundreds to thousands of years as groundwater, but there's no knowing what route each molecule might take. However, the fact that this and all of the other cycles have major components in the atmosphere does offer the opportunity for atoms to travel, which turns out to be crucial. But before I tell you why, a quick ad. We hear that you want merch, and we hear that you want to support Complexly. Did you know when you buy merch, you support us? It's true. So here's the deal. The SciShow store is having a huge summer sale right now because even the most generous people love a deal. You can support your favorite free science content on the web and get an extremely cool pin that everyone will love, like our Wandering Womb pin, inspired by the follies of doctors of old. If pins aren't your thing, we've still got you covered. It's hot out here, so you should probably stay hydrated. And what better way is there to enjoy your favorite beverage than in the SciShow Space Donut mug? You can sip all day while marveling at the fact that our universe may be shaped like a pastry. Or if you prefer your drinks in a can, keep it ice cold in our SciShow can koozie. We've even got a few favorite items from our SciShow Rock subscription that you can pick out, no membership required. Every rock and fossil has a story, so you can't go wrong. Selected merch is up to 45% off, so get it while it's hot. Be part of the nerdy things revolution. Head to complexly.store/sale now. The sale ends August 15th, so don't wait. Time and magnets are running out. The air is a freely mixing fluid, and scientists estimate that it takes about a year for molecules in the atmosphere to move from one hemisphere to the next. While there's a chance that some of Shakespeare's atoms have been locked away in rocks or deep in the ocean, the rapid biological cycles that use them keep many of them in active service, and the air keeps them moving. It's a reasonable assumption that in the 400 plus years since his death, the atoms that once called Shakespeare home are now distributed more or less uniformly across the planet. Although it's not possible to trace the fate of any single one of those atoms, we can make an educated guess as to where they've ended up using probability. If Shakespeare is now well mixed in the environment and we are ultimately built from atoms in the environment, then we can be expected to assimilate bits of the bard in the same proportion as they exist there. The number of Shakespeare's atoms in you will be the number of his atoms that exist, divided by the total number of atoms in the environment, multiplied by the number of atoms in your body. We already know the number of Shakespearean atoms in play. During his life and after death, he shed about 9 nonillion atoms. Calculating the total number of atoms in the environment is a bit more involved. The environment, for these purposes, comprises the parts of the Earth through which the biogeochemical cycles pass. It includes the low circulating part of the atmosphere called the troposphere, the ocean, a portion of the land surface, and living things. And just as we used mass and elemental composition to work out the number of atoms in a human body, we can do the same for each of these parts of the planet. I'll save you the math, but the troposphere has 3 times 10 to the 44 atoms, the oceans have 1.2 times 10 to the 47 atoms, a thickness of land about 1 meter deep is about 2 times 10 to the 43 atoms, and the biosphere has 3 times 10 to the 41 atoms. If you're already zoning out from all of the powers of 10, I do not blame you, but the takeaway here is that the oceans are much bigger than any of the others. They contain 400 times more atoms than the air, and 400,000 times more than all living things. So statistically speaking, the total number of atoms in the environment is around 1.2 times 10 to the 47. That's 12 with 46 zeros after it, equal to 120 quaterodecillion? I did not even know that number had a name. So we have the number of Shakespeare's atoms floating around and the total number of atoms in the environment. Dividing the first number by the second gives us the probability of randomly plucking one of Bill's atoms from the environment at 7.5 times 10 to the 17, or nearly 1 in a quintillion. I don't know about you, but 1 in a quintillion doesn't sound like great odds. Not sure I'd buy that lottery ticket. But we are not just buying one lottery ticket. To build a human body, we need to pick up a lot of atoms from the environment. Like, as we calculated before, 7 octillion of them. And when you're buying that many lottery tickets, even with vanishingly small odds, you're going to hit the jackpot eventually. Multiply the odds by the number of atoms you need, and voila, you've got your Shakespearean atomic winnings, which come out to about 525 billion atoms in every single one of us, just from randomly plucking them out of our air, water, and food. It sounds like a lot, even after dealing with all of those zeros, but consider this. 525 billion atoms is less than 100 trillionth of a percent of all of the atoms in your body. Now, purists might not consider the atoms that he breathed or peed during his life to be his true atoms. So if you only want to count the bits of him that were left when he died, then we have to adjust the number down a bit. Even so, it still comes out at about 400 million dead Shakespeare atoms in all of us. Maybe a bit less depending on the whereabouts of his skull. Now, there are a ton of assumptions built into all of these calculations. For one thing, we're assuming that after he died, all of Shakespeare's atoms were uniformly dispersed through the environment, but it's hard to know how true that is. The ocean is by far the biggest reservoir of atoms on the Earth's surface, and water tends to stay there for much longer than Shakespeare has been dead. So the H2O that ended up there might not make it back out to become a part of our bodies. And since carbon and nitrogen are such essential parts of all living things, they're more likely to keep churning in biogeochemical cycles. So we're more likely to inherit those parts of the bard than any of his other atoms. Taking time and place into consideration also introduces some interesting patterns. It goes without saying that the more recently someone lived, the less time their atoms have had to get mixed into the environment. So you're more likely to have Shakespeare in you than Marie Curie, for example. And if 400 years isn't enough to distribute atoms around the globe, then you're more likely to have Shakespeare in you if you live in England than if you live in Australia, because you're closer to where he lived and died. However, English pigs and sheep probably have a bigger chunk of the bard in them because they're directly grazing where he was buried and where his solid and liquid waste was deposited. The amazing thing is, pigs, sheep, Brits, Aussies, and all of us don't just have bits of Shakespeare in us. We have bits of everything and everyone. The conservation of atoms on Earth means that everything is recycled over and over again. The bits of us that were once part of Shakespeare may have also been a part of Cleopatra, a T-Rex, and the earliest life forms. And because we shed most of our atoms while we're still alive, there's a good chance that you have some of my atoms too. Running the numbers and allowing a decade or so for atoms to get around, about 400 billion of my atoms have made their way to you. Although I won't take offense if you think it's cooler to have Shakespeare's.